And good afternoon, gang. It's Friday, the 24th of March, 2017. Welcome along to today's United Kingdom Talk, coming to you from Royal Berkshire, boys and girls. Royal Berkshire. Oh, hang on, I haven't turned something on. Got to turn that on. Royal Berkshire. Do you know, every time I, just before I start, I check the date. It's in the computer, in the bottom of my computer screen down there. I check the date, and I check the day, and I check the year. And yet, when I come and speak to you, I can never remember what it is. Isn't that strange and mysterious? It really is. Very strange indeed. Hello to the early people today. Joe is with us. Hello from Warren, who is in Japan at the moment. La 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 la. He's a Japanese boy. Now, when we used to sing that at school, Warren, and I'm sure you were the same, dear, we would do it like this. La 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 la. He's a Japanese boy. But that is now considered racist. Now, why is that? Because it was never done seeking to offend anyone or anything like that. And it's usually screamed out racist by some middle-aged white bloke like myself. They're the people that are mainly offended. I mean, look at the state of half of them, dear. You know, I mean, there's not many people my age that look as good as this. Dear. Are you, go on, you've got to agree with that comment, haven't you? There's no... Hello, Warren. We've got three cameras going now, Warren. It's all very exciting. You'll see that as we go on. It's getting more and more professional, dear. It really is. Thank you very much to Joey and indeed anyone else who might have shared. Oh, Paul as well. Thank you very much, Paul. Thank you, those of you that have shared, already shared the today's video on your walls. Much appreciated, my darlings. Okay. Angela's with us, the lovely Angela Washington, a Barry Manilow supremo. She hasn't met Barry once. It's twice, I believed it. Twice she has met Barry Manilow. And there's me meeting, oh, I don't know, you know, just people like Linda Gray from Dallas, talking to Tony Blackburn. I mean, the stars are begging to coming here. I can't lie to you. The stars are begging to come in here. But the trouble is, if I have someone in here for a little bit of a chat, I don't call them interviews. They're informal chats. You know, it kind of, I don't find that I have enough time to say what I want to say then, lovey. Do you know what I mean? That's why you don't see me very rarely doing double headers. We can't be doing that. Although, I'm working on a little interview with someone. I am working. You wouldn't know him from the telly. He's a writer of one of Britain's best-loved comedy shows. My lips are sealed at the moment. I cannot reveal who that's going to be. We'll open a phone line a little bit later on. OK, boys and girls. Paul Dale is with us today. Hello, Paul. Nice to see you. Lovely Grant, who is DJ at the George and Dragon. Will you be working tonight, Grant? Will you be DJing of any music that anyone knows, or is it all obscure stuff, lovey? I met the Duchess last week. She popped into the Two Brewers. Oh, she's lovely. I love her so much. The Duchess. She's the landlady of a pub in London called the George and Dragon. Hello, Grant. Warren says, not politically correct. Exactly. That's what I'm saying. That's what we used to do. We can't do it anymore, lovey. No. Warren says, remember Chinese, Japanese, dirty knees. Yeah, I remember that. Wasn't that something we did at school? Chinese, Japanese, dirty knees. Something like that, wasn't it? Yeah. Can I do the messages that came in late from yesterday's show? I want to try and do those in future at the beginning, because by the end of this show, we'll have talked about loads of other stuff, you see. And then going back again, you think, well, what on earth is he talking about? So I just finished it. There's never too many. Simon says, we were talking about cruises, you know, on ships and things like that. Simon says, I've never been on a cruise, Mr. Chop Chop. He calls me Mr. Chop Chop. Because when I want something done fast, I was like, come on, chop chop, chop chop. I said that to one of the estate agents the other day. I'd never spoken to her. She had a French accent. And this was actually last year. And she was saying something, and I couldn't work out what she was. I said, oh, just pass me over to someone. So, well, I can leave a message with him. He's quite busy. I said, can you not just pass me over? She said, well, perhaps, can I not help you? Come on, chop chop, dear. Pass me over. She said, I will not chop chop. Stupid old bag. Just put me through to someone else, dear, who can speak proper English. I can't understand a word you're saying.
God's sake, how do these people get jobs? Jeez. Simon also says, last holiday I had was... Oh, sorry, I didn't finish that off. Never been on a cruise ship. My granddad actually died when the Titanic went down. He wasn't on the ship, he was on the iceberg hitching the lift. That's cruel. That's cruel. Poor granddad. Why did you stick him out there on the iceberg? That's just cruel, that is. You're horrible. You're the sort of people that work in old people's homes, aren't you? Nasty to elderly people. Vile. May the Lord strike you down with one of his bolts of lightning rapidly. Thank you. Simon also says, the last holiday I had was in Blackpool in the 1990s. I love it up there. The beach is really near the sea. I've got to say, you got me with that. The beach is near the sea. No, really? Isn't that strange? You don't see that often, do you? The beach being near the sea. Last time I went with a girl, she buried me in the sand and I buried her in the sand. And one day, I'll go back and dig her up. Have you seen the size of the wheel in the middle pier? What middle pier? I can't wait to see the size of the hamster. What wheel in a middle pier? What are you going on about, Simon, dear? Joanna says, I would never guess you were 57. Who told you I was 57, Joanna? I'm 54, 55 next year. Where on earth did you get 57 from? Are you paying full attention to our shows, Joanna? Honestly, dear, when I first saw you, I thought you was about 43 to 45. Yeah, I'm kind of happy with that. Was rather surprised when I found out. Well, you've been incorrectly informed, and I am unanimous in that. You have been incorrectly informed. I am indeed 54 years old. Thank you very much. And 55 next year, just to correct you there, OK? Good afternoon, Alan. See you tonight. And when you get a minute, can you check your WhatsApp? I shall check that later on, OK? Warren, stop that now. You've got to stop. Oh, Warren, did you know Tony Blackburn rang me up the other day? Yes, I'll tell you on private message because I've mentioned it a couple of times. People get fed up with me mentioning the same thing. Yeah, just after the show, Tony Blackburn rang me up the Monday before last and said he was really impressed and enjoyed the show. Isn't that fab? What had happened is that I'd been talking about him and someone had tweeted him. I can't work out those tweet things. I am on there. I am on the tweet. In fact, this show also, for a period of time, we're going on Periscope as well. Although that just seems to have fallen by the wayside, Periscope. Does anyone know what... Remember Periscope? It was started about a year ago. And it was excellent when it first started out. And it was basically this, you know... You could talk in front of your phone and people could watch whatever show you're doing. And at first it was really good. All sorts of people were doing different things. They'd set up their phone or camera, you know, in the kitchen, do a little bit of a cookery course. Some people would be out in the garden showing us plants and things. Now it's all right, mate. Yeah, yeah, how's it going? And all this with that deep South London accent, which I found offensive. You turn it on at night and go for London anytime after sort of 10 o'clock. Oh, it's awful. Awful. So I don't know what happened to that. And it's a great shame. It was a great shame. You weren't talking about me last night, were you, Warren? There must be other people that you can talk about, lovey. There really must. Right. Let's do some chit chat then today, boys and girls. I've been watching... Just before, this morning actually, while I was having, I didn't know if it was the right thing to watch while you're having breakfast, this programme on BBC 4 Colour, which was on last night, Porton Down. Did you ever see that? Now, Porton Down, I think, to be honest, I think it's mainly, Angela watches people on Periscope. Yeah, have you seen it as well, Angela? Do you like it? I mean, because if you type go into London at night, it just seems to be young males. Giving it some and all the girls come on, and it seems to be just like a pickup thing here in London. Maybe it's better in the States. I'll tell you what I'll do next time. I'll go around a few different countries and see if they're using it better, but they're not in London. It's just horrendous. It is, or is that just me being a bit stuck up? I don't know. You know, it'd be like comparing Barry Manilow to Kanye West. I don't know. That's a very good thing, really. Yes. So I was watching this programme about Porton Down. Now, it's probably better known for animal experimentation because, indeed, that's what they did. They experimented things on animals. Now, I don't really want to go down that route tonight. You probably know how I feel about animal cruelty, and I'm vegetarian because of that, okay? I don't want to go down that road today, except to say, you know, even though people like myself, you say, oh, you can't be experimenting on animals and all that business, most of us are here because of experiments done on animals and other humans as well. I mean, terrible what the Nazis did to the Jews years ago, testing out diseases on unwilling, on poor Jewish people. You may remember this, of course, in the war. And they were injected with all sorts of diseases. And the Germans developed vaccines and things like that to counter those germs. And that's why a lot of us are here, because of that. Sore throat. You've got a sore throat. You could be dead in a couple of years. Now you take a couple of pills and that's it. You know, so you do have to remember that before you go, oh, we mustn't experiment on animals and all that, which I agree with. You know, don't experiment on animals. We must remember that we are here because of those experiments placed on those people. Yeah. Anyway, so this Porton Down is probably better known for its experiments on animals. But what do they actually do there? In the war, it was set up as like a chemical weapons to find out, to actually create chemical weapons, but to do this so that if we were attacked in this country with chemical weapons, we would know what to do. And the presenter goes in there and mustard gas, I think, was it mustard gas? I think there is some gas, I think it's mustard gas. I might be wrong with that. No, I think I am wrong with that. There is a certain gas which makes you cough and your eyes stream and all that, but it doesn't actually kill you. And the presenter, an excellent presenter, he was taken into like a chamber, and they let the gas go. He's like, take your mask off now. And he took and his eyes were streaming and he was reaching a bit like that. And that's just a mild one. There's some really nasty stuff that's been created. And Porton Down was to do with chemical weapons, biological weapons, which I found even more frightening than the chemical stuff. Because generally, you know, chemical weapon, I suppose you fire it at someone and it lands and sets off its chemicals. And for a period of time, you know, those chemicals are around. But I think then they just disperse. I'm not a chemist. I'm not a scientist. I'm just guessing from watching the programme. But the biological ones, you know, they fire it off, it lands and it starts spreading. And a person picks up a disease from the biological thing, goes and mixes with his family and friends, and then they all get it and they mix with people. And it's even more frightening, the biological ones. I think they were quite frightened about Ebola, weren't they? Ebola. And then there's anthrax. Anthrax. They had a little, there's an island in Scotland where they tested out anthrax and they put a load of sheep on the island and made them breathe in this anthrax. And of course, they all died. And after the experiments, they had to close the island for 40 years because this anthrax spores were all spreading everywhere and they were in the ground. And apparently they can last dormant in the ground for years and years and years. You know, down to very low temperatures and up to very high temperatures, and they don't get killed. Terrible things that we come out with. So that was the island of Scotland. And then they have all these different gases, sarin. And I think the other one was VX or V1X or something like that. Really nasty stuff. And I think it was Saddam Hussein, of course, years ago, released this stuff on his own. Well, was it the Syrians or was it the Syrian regime? Or both. I think it might have been both, actually. And they released these nasty chemicals onto people. Dreadful way to go. Oh, my word. You know, the gas comes out and then they start choking and they literally drown. They drown themselves. Big blisters come up. Terrible, terrible things, these things. So that was very interesting. I highly... There's a couple of little animal bits in there which of course they upset me, that might upset you. Not masses of animal stuff. There's a little rabbit that they, it's a very old film. I think the film's about 80 years old, and there's a black and white film of a rabbit, and they test, I think it's sarin gas on him, or the VX one, something like that. And you see what happens to the rabbit. Although the kind of rabbit goes into fits and then just dies. You don't start seeing liquids and fluids coming out of the poor animal or anything like that. But it's a very, very interesting programme. And I highly recommend that. If you want to watch that on the BBC review, the iPlayer, OK? It was on BBC Four. For just type in Porton Down, P-O-R-T-O-N Down, and you'll find out all about that and the experiments that were going on there. OK, of course, we don't know exactly what goes on there. We can't know, can we? You know, how can they protect us if that sort of thing got out, what was going on there? So very, very good. Porton Down, it was on BBC Four either last night or the night before. It's on the iPlayer now. Watch it quickly, OK? Hello to Louise and Karen. They're with us today. Hello, Louise and Karen, you lovely people. Elaine is here in Israel. Hello, Elaine. You're right, sweetheart. Kiss, kiss. Jason Carter's with us this afternoon. Good afternoon, Jason. Young man. Thank you, Jason. It's a long time since I was called young man. Alan Russell is... got a little comment now because I was going to talk about robberies as well, which I'll come to in a second. All right. You will be able to call in this afternoon if you want to. There is a phone line open. Any of the subjects that we're talking about. Phone lines are open now. 020-8144-3477. OK. 020-8144-3477 is my phone in number. There's a Skype as well. If you want to Skype in, you can Skype in on United Kingdom Talk. All one word. United Kingdom Talk is the Skype in number. All right. So, now, I had something. What was the flowers there? Where's that gone now? What was I going to talk about? Something about flowers I was going to say to you this morning. I can't remember what the flower... Oh, yes, I do remember. It was... That's not going to work now. That was supposed to go in nicely to a little song I was going to sing you, but now I've mucked it up. I nearly said something out there. Now I've mucked it up, so that's not... Oh, shall I still do it anyway? Yes, all I was going to do is tell you that it's very cold this morning. When I got up this morning, it's very cold. I have been out already. Got up around about 9 o'clock. I think I got up at 9 o'clock this morning. And I had my breakfast and I wanted to go and have my haircut. So I jump on my bicycle. As I cycled down to Wokingham. And I noticed how cold it is, right? But good news, boys and girls. Good news. In this morning's Super Soar Away Sun, Britain, are you ready for this? Get your T-shirts and those tiny little micro bikinis ready. Yes. Warren, have you got a micro bikini that you're going to be wearing somewhere? What's the weather like in Japan anyway? Is it cold there or hot there? I don't know. Are they the same weather as us, Japan? You're not near that Fukushima thing place, are you? Is it Fukushima? Where they had the nuclear accident a few years ago. Frightening, that stuff, dear. Anyway, if you want to get a quick suntan, all you got to do is go and stand next to your local nuclear power station. A guaranteed suntan every time. It really is. Anyway, it's coming soon. Britain is set to enjoy temperatures hotter than the Canary Islands this weekend as the weather finally springs into action for a scorcher. Just in time for Mother's Day. Now, when they say scorcher, you know, when you hear me say scorcher, when you say scorcher, you probably think of temperatures about 80, 90 degrees Fahrenheit, don't you? Eh? Wait, I'm not doing centigrade, dear. You don't want me to do centigrade. It's foreign. We voted for Brexit. We're not doing centigrade anymore. It's back to Fahrenheit. Let's go back to the good old days. La. Yes, back to the good old days. So the good news, boys and girls, is temperatures will rocket as high as... Oh, it's in centigrade. 16 degrees centigrade. 16, 26, 33, 31, 32, 42, 52, 62, 63. So that's about 64. I mean... I mean, it's hardly a scorcher, is it? Come on. 64 degrees Fahrenheit, 16 centigrade. It's hardly a scorcher. This is how the sun's talking about it. It's going to be a scorcher, you know, a whole 64 degrees. Well, we might just get away with going out in a T-shirt and no jumper. Might be able to. Might be a bit chilly for some of you that are old and decrepit like myself, unfortunately. This is what the Met Office is predicting. It says, in contrast, Tenerife is set to enjoy 17. Only one extra degree in Tenerife. Oh, my friend Keith George lives in Tenerife. So there you are, boys and girls. Spring is on its way. Soon flowers will be appearing for everyone, boys and girls. Oh, yes. The flowers are coming now. When it's spring again, I'll bring to you tulips from Amsterdam. With a heart that's true, I'll give to you tulips from Amsterdam. I can't wait until the day you feel these eager arms of mine. Like the windmill keeps on turning, that's how my heart keeps on yearning for the day I know we can share these tulips from Amsterdam. Yes, that's where you want to be. Amsterdam, sending flowers to everyone, boys and girls. Mother's Day, don't you dare forget your mother on Mother's Day. I'll be really disappointed if you forget your mother on Mother's Day. We're going to have to do a special on Mother's Day. That's it. We're going to do our special. Get your mothers round and get the show on and you can wish them a happy Mother's Day live on this programme. How exciting is that? My God, the last time I was that excited, I was queuing up to go and see Beauty and the Beast this week, the wonderful Disney show that is on now. Elaine says, don't quit your day job. What's wrong with my singing? Beg pardon, dear? Oh, you mean the calculations? I don't know. When do you move your clocks forward, Elaine wants to know. That's on Sunday. Tick, tick, tocking, moving clocks forward on Sunday, which means I'll probably have to go to a different church because there's no way I'm going to be able to get up at 7:30 when it's really 6:30. And then I won't have gone to bed till 2:00 in the morning. So I'll probably have to go to a later mass this week. Lee Cobby says, I've just got back from Wokingham. Well, I was just down there, Lee. Really? Oh, what are the... apparently, the traffic is really bad there now in the afternoon in Wokingham because they're redoing Wokingham. So I left this morning, 10 o'clock in the cold, and I'm cycling down towards Wokingham. It takes about... it's about a 25-minute cycle, and it's a nice cycle. It's nice and easy. I do have to go... do you know the Waterloo Road, Lee? I have to cycle along that Waterloo Road, which is a bit of a fast road, that one, but it's okay. And... I've come out of my house where I live. I've turned right and I have to go through under an underpass. This is on a cycleway, so no road. It's like a shared path with walking people, pedestrians, walking people. That's not to say if you're in a wheelchair, you're not included as well, which of course you are. Oh dear, we get that a lot, yeah. Oh, what about the people in wheelchairs? Never mention those. What about people with one leg? You never mention those. Well, I'm mentioning you now, all right? So that's for the walking people, the people in wheelchairs and those with one leg as well. Just in case you were feeling left out. Oh, God, what you have to do in this politically correct world these days, dear. So I'm walking along there. And the path was half blocked up with builders, boys and girls. Builders. Not cute ones either. Very disappointed. They were a bit fat. A bit sort of my size. I was so disappointed. You know, where are these young lads in the grey tracksuit bottoms and no top on, although it was a bit cold? Very disappointed. Fat builders they were. And quite honestly, I mean, when I say it was half, the path was half blocked off, that wasn't with building materials. The building materials were on the grass. It was their fat asses sticking out over the path. Oh, it's disgusting. Anyway, so I'm coming along, getting to them. And as they saw me, fair enough, they moved in a little bit. And I thought, oh, that's nice. Now, it's a terraced house. There was one, two, I think there's 4 or 5 houses next to each other. And they're building a little wall over this bit of, around this little bit of garden. Now, I'm not being funny, right? This bit of garden is about 6 foot by 6 foot. And they're putting not even that, no. No, it's about 1, 2, what's this then? Oh, yeah, it could be. Yeah, this bit of garden's about 6 foot by 10 foot, and they're putting a brick wall around it. I mean, what is the point? What is the point in doing that? I can understand it out the back garden, but to cut off that tiny little bit there, what's all that about? You might as well have had a porch there, a porch. Just a tiny little wall. Anyway, as I'm going past it, so they're doing their work. Honestly, there's this radio blaring out that they've got on the floor with a good bass speaker, bass bin within the radio itself. Bang, 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 it was going. This is like 10 o'clock in the morning. Now, I know everyone's gone out to work usually at that time, but I'd be really fed up if I was one of the other houses, wouldn't you? I thought we were going to turn that radio down and get on with your work quietly. What a blooming liberty, dear. Outrageous. I quite like a brick wall around my around mine. I've got a wooden fence, the same as everyone else. I think it'd be a bit ostentatious, wouldn't it, really? That's a good word, isn't it? I'm not even sure what it means. It just felt like it was a good idea to drop that word in, just in case anyone from the BBC is watching today and wants to offer me a show, just to let you know I can do long words occasionally, like ostentatious. All right. But if you do give me a job on the BBC, I will have to have my Oxford English Dictionary with me now and again. And now and again, if you don't think I'm doing enough long words, like what Victoria Derbyshire uses in the morning. Oh, good morning and welcome to the Victoria Derby Show. I'm very, very posh. Very, very posh Victoria Derbyshire, who I like very much, incidentally. yes, so that's the brick wall. So I continued. I continued with my journey. And got to Wokingham. First of all, I go to the bank. I go to the bank, first of all, to drop in my wages. Because I don't like to, that's the first thing. If I've ever got to go to the bank, I'll do that first. Because you never know, you might lose your money. You could be robbed, dear. Robbed. Robbed on the way to the bank or the hairdressers. You know, I went to the hairdressers first. You know, I could put my coat down, got it all, and that's £10 or whatever it is, please. And someone's nicked all your money. Better to only lose the £25 held back for shopping and haircutter than the other money that you're putting in a bank. So I went to the bank first, dropped that in there, and I came back, and they're rebuilding Wokingham. And they've actually closed off one side of the road. They used to have two lanes there. There's only one lane of traffic now. And so I think there's two that come that way. So it's three lanes going into one. Oh, that traffic is chock-a-block there. It really is. So I cycled to it, and then I'll push my bike on the pavement back to the hairdressers. Avoiding people as you go, you know. You've got a few great big things coming towards you with prams.
I've got a buggy. Get out of my way. I've got a buggy. I've got a buggy. I've got right of way over everyone and everything, and I can go where I want. I've got a buggy. You know, those sort of people. Although they're quite actually few and far between in Wokingham. It's a nice place, Wokingham.
You know, it's not like going into some of the dumps. It's not like going into Camden Town or somewhere like that. What a dump that is, isn't it, eh? Oh, my God. It's filthy, disgusting people walking around all over the place. Wokingham is not like that. It has nice people like me, for example. Like you. You'd fit in Wokingham. You absolutely would. Got to the hairdressers, parked up. And as I walked in, I was so pleased to see my favourite boy hairdresser was sitting there just reading his paper, obviously with nothing to do. And I walked in and his little pretty boy face lit up. Hello, sir, how are you? And he's so polite and nice. He really is. It goes without saying he's not English. Because if he was English, he probably wouldn't be nice and polite like that. He's a lovely. And he always, generally, he always cuts my hair. So I sat down, usual, sir, yes, please. And we're just chit-chatting about general things and that. And the other staff all come and talk to me. And it's all very, very nice in there, in the hairdressers. So that was over. And we were asking, he was asking about my life and what have you. And I told him I was married once. 1983, I was married. And all these things. And he was asking if I had any children and all this and what have you. And got to the end. And so I got up as usual. And he asks you to turn around. He gets a brush and brushes you down. I had the flame in the ear. The cutthroat razor. All shaped up here. Look how nice he does it all. Then I have some sort of, like a raspberry cream or something like that, that he rubs into your head, which is very nice. Bit of a massage going on there. A little spray of lemon and off. Time to go. Anyway, It's usually £10. So I got my £10 out and his tip. Now, I'm going to let you into a little secret here, okay? Just a tiny little secret. Little secret. He gets the biggest tip. All right? I shouldn't really tell you. He does get the bigger tip than anyone else in there. All right? I shouldn't move away from the microphone. He does get the bigger tip than anyone else, but don't tell anyone else that, okay? So I've given him £10. He said, oh, it's 13 now. Oh, right. Okay. And I thought, you know, quickly that went through my mind. I thought, that's gone up a little bit, hasn't it? Okay, is it 13? He said, but you don't have to pay that today if you don't want to. It's just in future. I said, no, if that's what it is now. I said, when did that go up then? You know, because it was £9 last year, then it was 10, now it's 13. He said, oh, there's a sign on the front of the desk. Well, you don't look, do you? You don't look. And on the front of the desk, indeed, is a sign. And it says, the gentleman's haircuts from Monday to Thursday, they've changed it. So Monday to Thursday, it's £10. Friday, Saturday and Sunday is 13 quid, dear. Well, I didn't know whether to feel ripped off or not. He did. The manager was there as well. And they're lovely people, lovely people. The manager was there as well. And he said, yeah, we're doing a new price structure now. He said, Monday to Thursday, it's still £10. Friday, Saturday and Sunday is £13. Presumably they're busier Friday, Saturday and Sunday. But there was no one in there when I went in there. So I begrudgingly handed over this £13. But I didn't make it look like I was begrudged. Is that a word or not? I don't know. I didn't make it look. I just handed over the 13, but I only give him a couple of pound tip today. Oh, we've got to come back from somewhere, dear. So that £10, I think I gave him 16 in the end. Well, I usually would have given him 14. I'm a good tipper. Oh, yeah. Believe it. Seriously, I'm a good tipper. Anyone who does jobs for me, anything like that, if I go, especially to America, you must understand when you go to America, a lot of their wages are made up from, they get very, very poor money. People working in restaurants. And this is where the English really muck up when they go to the States, because it's not like that here. But you have to respect, I say you have to respect other countries when you go there. I mean, if only they could do the same when they come here, some of them. You know what I mean? But wherever I go in the world, I will respect that. It's like when I went to Israel and there were certain places they wanted me to wear a kappa, which is the little hat that they wear. And I went to the prayer wall. What is it? Is it called the Wailing Wall? I think the Wailing Wall, where they all go, all the special proper Jewish people go and they pray at this wall. And when you go there, they ask you to wear a hat. So I fit in. You must do what they want you to do. And in America, most of their wages is made up of tips. They might only be getting $1 or $2 an hour working in restaurants. So you must tip them. You must tip them a decent amount. And I'm a good tipper. I am a good tipper. But not today. I took £1 off the normal tip as it has suddenly gone up to £13. And I thought, I've just been ripped. I actually felt I'd been ripped off. I did, because there was no warning of it. You know, if they'd have said, well, next time, I'm afraid it's going up to £13. But if you come in Monday to Thursday, so I'm going to have to change my day now when I go and have my haircut, which actually does work out, because Friday, it's a bit of a rush around for me. I mean, it's like, you know, it's 20 to 3 now. Today, I like to be in bed by about 3:15, 3:30 for a couple of hours sleep before I go and do the karaoke later on at Central Station. But I did. I felt ripped off. Would you have felt ripped off there? I don't know, really. I mean, I did. I felt a little bit peeved about that. Even though I do like them all in there, and as I say, you know, it's the boy usually that cuts my hair, but they're all very good in there. They're all excellent haircutters in there. And there's another lady from, I think she's from Malaysia. She's lovely. She is. She's really, really nice, the lady from Malaysia and all that. So I did that. Paid my £16 instead of 14. most disappointing. Then I went to do some shopping in Marks and Spencer because they've got a little food department there. And it's a particular thing I go there in there for. They do a onion and mushroom pie, which is like onion and mushroom in some sort of gravy and potato topping, which is absolutely delicious. That's about £2.50, something like that, and a couple of vegetables. So I bought two of those. And I got in my little basket and round to the front, had a little bit of a laugh with the members of staff. I talked to everyone, you know. Oh, yes. And what did I say to her? I can't remember what I said to her now. Don't know, but they're always very friendly. The staff in Waitrose and Marks and Spencers have always got time to talk to you. They really have. So I did that. And then I paid me money. I put my shopping in my recyclable Marks and Spencers bag. And then I went to leave. And as I went out the exit door, there was some scummy bloke, youngish, about 25, 26. He had an old pair of dirty tracksuit bottoms on and really rough looking, unshaven. And he's got his head down like this. And as I was coming out, I could see him looking in the window because there's like an entrance. And then to the left and to the right is like stock, you know, shoes, shirts, trousers, stock, you know, stock. And he is looking in this window. And as I come out, he looked at me and I looked at him and straight away I thought, you're here to nick something. I knew straight away. And then he went in. And I kind of stopped at the window, at the other window next to it. And I pretended to go on my phone. And he went straight round the other side where no one else was. So I thought, I'm not having any of this because I can't stand people who nick. It just annoys me. We are paying more for stuff because of people that nick. It's a bit like those programs on the telly that, you know, that the one I was talking about the other day, Britain on the Fiddle. It's the same thing. You nick from a shop, then the money you pay for stuff will go up to cover that. And I thought, I'm not having any of that. So I've gone back in. As I've gone in, I've looked around and there's a lady coming towards me, a member of staff, you know, pushing a trolley. I said, excuse me. I said, there's a really dodgy bloke walking around now. I think he's about to try and nick something. She said, well, oh, she said, yeah, I can see it. Yep, OK. Thank you very much, sir. Thank you very much. I said, do you want any? She said, no, please leave it to us. Thank you very much. And that was it. So I came back out again and I had a look around and she had walked over to the area that he was near. He's obviously, and he's come straight back out again and walked down the road. So, I mean, it's terrible, isn't it? Terrible. So I informed him. And I just wondered this afternoon, Bozzy goes, have you ever seen anything like that going on in a shop? Or maybe you've had experience yourself of being burgled. Did you ever catch the burglar? Have you caught a burglar? Did you report them? Did you make an anonymous phone call or did you apprehend them yourselves? If you did, I'd love to know about that this afternoon. Burglary. I don't know how you say it. Burglary of any type whatsoever, whether it's nicking some sweets at a sweet shop or an armed raid on a bank. Have you ever experienced anything like that? Then I'd love to know about it this afternoon. Give us a call. 020-8144-3477 is my local London call-in number. Remember, that's not a premium rate number. You're not going to be charged £1.75 a minute or anything like that. It's just a normal local number. If you've got probably on your mobile telephone thing, if you've got minutes on that, it will just come out of the normal minutes. It's a normal local London number. 020-8144-3477 is my phone number. We've also got the Skype. If you've got Skype, then you can Skype in. And my Skype in name is United Kingdom Talk. All one word, no spaces. United Kingdom Talk, the Skype in, and the phone number 020-8144-3477. All right. So after that, I came home. I immediately put one of my lovely onion pies, mushroom and onion pies in the oven. Ate that, then watched the rest of that Porton Down programme. And then here I am, come up here to chat to you for half an hour or so. I thought it would only be a short show today, actually. Although we've been chatting now for 40 minutes non-stop as usual, haven't we? Jerry says, I like the camera changes. Yeah, we've got three cameras in here now, Jerry. And I'm quite proud of that, actually. I managed to get another widescreen camera, which is this one over here. I managed to get another one of those over there. See? Hello. And I got that one from eBay. Cheaper, only 40 quid. And though they're about 80 quid generally, though. So I got a second-hand one from eBay, and that it works perfectly. But I was a bit concerned that it wouldn't work, because if you plug in the same webcam, that's the same manufacturer and the same make and the same model, if you plug that into a laptop, you can have problems with that. But I was very lucky, and it seems to have worked perfectly. So I've actually got three in here now. One behind me just over there, as you just saw, and sort of a close-up one that's just over there that you saw when I was singing Tulips from Amsterdam. Oh, yes. Hello to Adam, who's with us this afternoon. Good afternoon, Adam. All right, still on holiday in Gran Canaria. I hope you're having a wonderful time there. Ben Parker's with us. Good afternoon, Ben. Burglarizing. Burglarizing. Well, that sounds good. Burglarizing. Has anyone been burglarized? That's a great word. Burglarized. Is that something you just made up, Ben? I don't know. Hello to Emily Levine. Good afternoon to Emily. And Elaine says, does Nick mean steal? Yes. Thieves, Elaine. Nick does mean steal. We can't be doing with knickers. Ben says, kippah is Hebrew. Yarmulke is Yiddish. What I don't know what Yiddish is. I'm not quite sure what Yiddish is. So I had a kippah on, didn't I? I had a kippah on my head when I went to... Elaine. Yeah, that's right, Elaine. And, you know, I do think, you know, whenever you go to other places, you must respect what they do. And if I was to ever go to Turkey, well, we have them over. If I were ever to go to a mosque or something like that, you know, I would take my shoes off, because that's what they do, isn't it? You should respect what always other people do. Elaine says it's the Western Wall, not the Wailing Wall. I thought it was called the Wailing Wall. What's the Wailing Wall then? Is that something else? Or is that something that I don't know what other people call it, actually. Lee, Max Hair and Beauty Salon. That's right, that's where I go. That is where I go. So do you know the boy I mean? he's the third one down. Oh, we do have a laugh. We have a chat with him and a laugh in there. But £13, I thought that's gone up a bit much. So I'm going to have to change my hairdressing day now to Thursdays. Either Tuesdays or Thursdays I'll do my hair now in future, when it's only £10. Thank you very much. We can't afford to lose money left, right and centre like that. Lee was in Costa Coffee. Yeah, I go there. I usually sit in there with my mate having a cup of tea, Lee. Well, well, well. But it won't be on a Friday anymore. Not for £13, dear. It will in future probably be on a Tuesday or maybe a Thursday when I'll go in future, OK? Ray Reynolds is with us. Good afternoon from Woodford Green. And greetings to all of Mr. Chris Reardon's Facebook One Colour viewers. Yes, indeed. Oh, the phone's ringing now. Just a minute. Let's see who this is. Hello. Hello. Good morning. Good afternoon. I'm just doing a worldwide television spectacular at the moment with 13 million viewers and listeners watching at the moment, darling. Thank you. Bye-bye and God bless you. Goodbye. Oh, yeah, that's my mate there. Yes. Let me see. Ba-ba-ba-ba. What is a baggy? Did I say a baggy? Oh, no, a buggy. You mean a buggy. A buggy, Elaine, is like, it's a modern pram. You know, the prams that they push children around in. Do you know, I've got to say, when I see those buggies that they have now, they don't look very strong to me. Do they, you? When you compare, Elaine, perhaps the pram that maybe you were pushed around with, and it would be a great big thing on springs, wouldn't it? Do you remember those? Wheels like this, great big wheels on there. Big springs, and it would rock backwards and forwards. And they look really solid. These buggies just look like little plastic things with tiny little wheels. And you know the noise of that buggy. I'm scared when they come towards me. There's a group of ladies round here, young ladies, who go on this keep fit group thing where they go walking around with their buggies, around the sports centre that I use, okay? And then they start running. And it's scary. You see them all coming towards you, running with their blasted buggies. And some of them are fast, some of them are slow. Some, and they're obviously the ones that have just had the babies and haven't, and it's their first visit to the keep thing. Sod that. Just go home and have a cup of tea, darling. It's a lot easier. That's where I'd be. I wouldn't be running around with a buggy like that. Thank you. Ben says, ostentatious, pretentious or showy display means designed to impress. Thank you, Ben. Thank you. I wish I could impress someone. I don't know. Right, let's just do a couple of messages. We've got a couple of stories to do as well, boys and girls. No one calling in today, which is fine. Okay, if you don't want to call in, that's all right. I don't mind. Ray says, in the States, buggies are called strollers. We don't really call them prams, but I think there's a difference between a pram and a buggy. A pram is like a proper thing, what a child, a little baby is laying in. Very comfortable. They never seem to look comfortable in those buggies. My niece has got a buggy, and it's like a double-decker. Now, you've all seen the ones where you get two children next to each other. They're the ones that take up the entire pavement, dear. And they won't move out of the way. No, you've got to go in the road. They won't move that buggy an inch over to the side so you can get past. But my niece it's like a double-decker buggy. So one child sits up there and the other child sits behind it. I mean, I wouldn't like to be the one behind. Couldn't see a damn thing, could you? How do you know if a large bus is coming towards you if you're sitting in the back? Very frightening, very frightening. Yes. Thank you, Elaine. So the Western Wall is also called the Wailing Wall. It's the same one. So thank you very much. And Yiddish is the Jewish language similar to German. Thank you very much. Alan is Jewish as well. It's called a kapel. A kapel, the hats that they wear. Thank you very much. Good afternoon to Shania, who's with us this afternoon. Afternoon, Shania. Alan says, I was queuing up at the lottery counter in Tesco a couple of months ago when they heard the alarm go off and a guy stole a toaster. And my mate Alex, who is a security guard there, had trouble holding him. So I helped him back into the store and waited for the local police to come. Good. Good. I'm glad that happened. Yeah. Sometimes I've been in Waitrose before. And he's such a nice man, the security guard in there. And he's got dreadlocks and always very smart. And he wears this suit and he's a lovely bloke. I always have a nice chat to him. But you're very aware while he's chatting to you, you can see him looking around, you know, waiting for evil thieves. And I've seen him in action. It's usually him and a young lad who's he can only be about 24, 23. He seems to like getting involved in the security aspect of things. So he will run after someone. And what they do, when they catch them, they frog march them into the office and they put them in some sort of cage, dear, waiting for the police to get them, nick them. Good, good. But I don't think it's good enough for people to just be nicked like that. They need to be taken outside into the car park and beaten and flogged in front of everyone else so that it doesn't blooming well happen again. They should have done the same to that bloke from Marks and Spencer's. I don't know if he got anything. He needs to be dragged out and beaten in front of people. Oh, you can't do that. Oh, no. No, the human rights won't allow that. Oh, sod the human rights. They need to be dragged out of the supermarkets and beaten in front of everyone else. Perhaps the price of my bread will go down a penny then. Then I'll be happy. Thank you. Emily says, I agree. I told my husband last night, when you're in another country, you respect their customs. Absolutely. You know, you often, I've heard stories before about English people. Who have gone to places like, Arabian type places. Is that correct? Arabian places like Saudi Arabia, where they're not supposed to drink alcohol. And what do? They take a can of lager out and drink it in the street. I mean, how stupid can you be? Respect their laws. Terrible, stupid people. Emily says, you want the same when someone comes into your house, so you do that in another country. We were discussing friends who travelled recently to India. Now, there looks a wonderful place, India. I've been watching that programme on the telly, The Real Marigold Hotel. Not the film, it's a TV series where these pensioners go. And they want to see what it would be like to retire to India. And it seems a wonderful, such wonderful people. Friendly, warm, wonderful people. But I don't think I could eat anything. Although I do like, I had years ago when I was eating meat, I did have a couple of beef curries. Oh my God, that I don't know what the spice was, but it was delicious. And they put so much on that I was sweating. Oh, talking about sweating, I've noticed now, you see this little bit on my head that's missing, right? Or you'll see it better on that one. Hang on a minute. Just right, you see that bit there? All right, you see that bit there? Yeah? Well, I've noticed now, if I have one of my favourite meals, spaghetti arrabbiata, or whatever it's called, you know, the really chilly one, spicy chilly one, if I have that bit on my head starts getting all sticky. Do any other bald people have that problem? Alan, do you get that? Do you eat curries and things like that? If it's really spicy, does the top of your head get sweaty? Oh, dear me. Now, I think Alan sent something in about... here we are. There's another one here. Alan says, talking about robberies, I was in a betting shop with my best friend when two guys came in and made us go on the floor and made off with about £3,000. Oh, and you were terrified, weren't you? Oh, I couldn't do that. Well, you just hand over the money, didn't you? You just hand over the money, you know. You don't argue and take the bloody money, you know. You obviously need it more than me. And that's it. Dennis says, hello to Dennis, who says, sorry I keep popping in and out. I have to keep pesky customers coming into the shop, so we have to keep turning you off. Why am I being turned off when there are other customers? I would have thought, you know, if perhaps you could advertise the show on your shop door, I think people would come in and browse while they're listening. I mean, I'm happy to provide that as a free service. We can't afford to lose listeners left, right and centre when they leave the shop. Make them stay, dear. Lock the... There should be a button on your door. You push the button. The moment a customer enters, you push the button and switch on timer that have to stay a minimum of 45 minutes to browse in your shop and listen to my words of wisdom. Elaine thinks taking people outside and beating them is a bit harsh. I don't think so, Elaine. No! Drag them out and beat them. Beat them down. Don't neck from my shop like that. They have to be beaten, Elaine, and that's the only way there is to it, dear. All this prison stuff, dear. Do me a favour. They're all sitting in there playing on their Sony PlayStations. Or playing board games or doing some sort of watching some telly. I mean, I wouldn't mind if the prisoners, you know, had access to one of my shows. That would be a good idea. I reckon, here's the thing. If prisoners up and down the countries, in the whole world, were forced to watch my shows for hours a day, I don't think they'd offend again. I really don't. They wouldn't offend again if they were forced to sit there and watch my show. Emily says, on the subject of the buggies, we have one that lays back. They can sit up and it has a pull on the back where you can recline them if they sleep. I mean, I'm quite liking the sound of that. I might come where you are. That'd be quite nice if I can be pushed around somewhere like that. Elaine says, are you a descendant of Sir George Mackenzie? Who's he? What does he do? What does he do? George Mackenzie. Is that another name that you've just plucked out of the air, Elaine? Dennis says, are the people of St. Ives ready for you? I should blooming well think so, yes. Emily says, the Indian people, wonderful, friendly people. They just walked around and did life like they do in India. They went to Taj Mahal and a monk school on the banks of the Ganges. And everyone wanted his photo because he is blonde. They are fascinated. I think I'd quite like to go to India. That does sound quite a nice place to go. Lovely, lovely people. Lovely, lovely people. Oh, I'm very pleased to see that Ray Reynolds is popping along to the karaoke tonight. Sven is visiting from La Suede. Oh, the Swedes. The Swedes. They, I think, are now the most winners of the Eurovision Song Contest. Ba, 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 ba. Have you heard the English song? No chance at all. I've heard two songs only. The English one, no chance at all. Bottom five, maybe bottom three. And I've heard the Irish one as well. No, not good. So they're the only two that I've heard so far. All right. Okie doke. Now, let me see. What have I got here? Oh, I've got just one more story for you today, which was sent in from the excellent friend of the show, Mr. Johnny Key. Now, here's the thing. When you go to a public lavatory, whether it be in a pub or somewhere like that, are you a little bit too using of the toilet paper? I bet you are, aren't you? You know, when you're at home, aren't you? You're sitting there, you finish your business, and you just carefully take off a towel. I bet when you're out somewhere, you pull the old roll off. I mean, I've probably sat next to you in the cubicle next door, listening to that roll going round and round as you stuff your pockets full of free tissue paper. Well, look at this. A park in Beijing. Now, why do they call it? Why did they change it from Peking? Anyone know that? Why did they change the name of Peking to Beijing all those years ago? Isn't that strange and mysterious? It is. A park in Beijing has installed toilet paper dispensers with facial recognition to stop visitors from taking too much loo roll, like you. I bet you do that, don't you? You've been taking too much loo roll, you naughty person. It's outrageous, outraged. Machines at the Temple of Heaven Park. Oh, that sounds nice, doesn't it? Where should we go? Oh, let's go to the Temple of Heaven Park. I like the sound of that. Scans visitors' faces before dispensing a fixed-length strip of paper. Absolutely, yes. That's it. You just get the one length. The tourist attraction... Oh, stop moaning. There's sinks you can wash your hands in afterwards if you haven't got enough. The tourist attraction is reportedly frequented by visitors who take large amounts of loo roll home. Who's been nicking toilet paper? That's very, very naughty of you. It has reignited debate about the lack of social graces among some of the Chinese. Park officials have installed six machines at its public bathrooms in a half-month trial with staff on standby to explain the technology to visitors. The park has retained its existing loo roll dispensers. The new machines, placed at average heights for men and women. So, oh, talking of average heights, do you know, the toilets in the sports centre that I go to, they're too high. Do you know what I mean? I have to use a disabled one because I can't be going to the toilet with my legs swinging backwards and forwards, dear. They've put them too high. Do you find that sometimes you'll use a public toilet and it's too high? I hate that. They dispense strips of toilet paper measuring about 24 to 27 and a half inches to each person. 24. Well, that's quite long, isn't it? That's got to be the length of your TV screen, isn't it? Yeah. They will not dispense more paper to the same person unless 9 minutes have passed. Well, you could be there all day if you're having problems, couldn't you? What about my IBS? What about my IBS? There's been times I've got through more than a couple of rolls in one go. Oh, it's terrible, IBS. Hope you never get it. I'm hoping that I'll grow out of it at some point. If we encounter guests who... Okay, now it's at this point where I have to tell you, if you're eating something, you may not want to hear this bit. So just turn the sound off for about 30 seconds. You ready? Here it comes. If we encounter guests who have diarrhea or any other situation in which they urgently require toilet paper, then our staff on the ground will direct provide the toilet paper, a park spokesman had told the Beijing War. What do you do? I mean, do you not... Hello? Could you get some more toilet paper? Or do you have to open the door and shuffle out with trousers around your ankles? Have you ever done that before? I bet you've done that at home, haven't you? I've just been to, there's no toilet paper. And then, rather than pull up your trousers, you shuffle to the cupboard where the toilet rolls are. Is that what you do? The park also upgraded the toilet paper quantity from one ply to two ply. Oh, that's even better. I want to move to China just to use this toilet. Earlier this month, Chinese media reported that visitors to the Temple of Heaven's park toilets were taking excessive amounts of toilet paper, some of whom were seen stuffing them in their bags. The park has been aware of this problem for years, which began shortly after it started dispensing free toilet paper in 2007. So that's that. There's a picture here. Look, there's a picture of the toilet paper dispensers on the BBC website. Thank you to the BBC for that story. An excellent story to our colleagues. Not really colleagues, are they? To our I wish they were colleagues of mine. I wish I could be a colleague of the BBC. Now, there was one other thing I wanted to show you. This kind of ties in with that. And then we'll do the birthdays and then we'll disappear this evening, this morning, boys and girls. Okay. So these are, do you remember I said Johnny Key a couple of days ago recommended, because I've got an incontinent elderly cat, unfortunately, Katie. And she goes all over the floor and, oh, it's just a nightmare. I have to mop the kitchen floor twice a day now. It's a nightmare. I've got newspaper down, but it doesn't really do the job because the newspaper falls apart. I mean, I don't know where all the wee comes from. Where does all her wee come from, for Lord's sake? Ah, thank you, Adam. Adam says, the correct height for a toilet is 16 inches. Thank you very much. Oh, that's a lot of inches, isn't it? 16, dear me. Thank you, 16 inches. Do you know, I'm going to measure the toilet. Is that to the top of the bowl? I'm going to measure that toilet in the sports centre and I'll inform you what it is. I shall secretly take in a tape measure and measure that toilet. Yes. Oh, dear. Right. So, Johnny Key recommended these puppy training pads. Look, only £10 from Amazon. I haven't opened this yet. And apparently you can put these on the floor. Come round here. You can't see this properly, can you? There we are. Is that better? There we are. Puppy. Here we are. Where's my microphone? Puppy training pads. Check this out. Look. Okay. And he said what you do is put these on the floor and that should assist. And it says here, although it's for a cat, puppy training pads are the easy way to house train your puppy, specially scented to encourage your pet to return to the pad to relieve itself. Our pads are highly absorbent, locking away moisture and odours within their six layers of super absorbent core. So you get 50 of these and it's 10 quid. So I'm going to replace them. I'll probably put these on top of the newspaper. Let's have a look at one of them. Never had these before. Oh, look, here we are. Look, oh, this is good. Puppy training pads. Oh, they're not very thick. Oh, they're quite big. Look. Look at that. There we are. Look. So white on one side and grey on the other. I mean, what do you do? Just. Oh, there's. What's that there? That's just like a. Ah! So it's got these four corners as well, right? And if you take up off, there's a bit of sticky there. Ah, so the white bit must go down onto the ground, I would guess. And it would just stick to the floor. So I'm going to surround her a little lit. Actually, this could help me with my IBS, couldn't it? I could wear these. While I'm in the car going to work, I won't have to rush into pubs then suddenly at the last minute. Which actually, I've been lucky. It hasn't been happening now recently, not since I stopped taking the antibiotic. I mean, how would I attach these to myself? Let's give this a go. I could put them on. There, that would work, wouldn't it? How would I attach that to myself? Maybe a bit of gaffer tape or something like that. There we are. Look at these. Human nappies. Oh, Lord. I think that's an excellent idea. Human. So that'd be for my cat. I might wear one myself. If I think I'm going to have an accident, I might put one on myself on the way to work. Yes, that's an excellent idea. All right, let's do today's birthdays, boys and girls. It's birthday time. First of all today, happy birthday to Chris Moses. He ran and invented one of the world's very first online radio stations, CMP Radio. And I think this must be going back at least 12 years or so now. And I was doing a little show. This is how I got into radio. I was doing a show on a thing called Live 365. I don't know if they're still around. Chris bought about his own online radio station and I went and did a show on there. And he's very, very clever. It's his birthday, though. So happy birthday today to Chris Moses. Happy birthday. Happy birthday today to the lovely Annie Mills. Oh, sing a song, sing out loud, sing out strong. I always knew I should have done a duet with you, Annie. Happy birthday to Annie, darling. Jim McGurk, happy birthday to you, sir. To Chris Strickland, 55 today with the cowboy hat on. Happy birthday, Chris. John Boyce today is 47 years old. Kevin Lane, hello Kevin, 41 today. Where's all these years going? Kevin was on one of those house programs. I think do up your own house or buy a house. Home in the Country, I think it was. Home in the Country. It was on that about a year or so ago. Happy birthday, Chris. And happy birthday to Radio Extraordinaire, 61 years old today, to the lovely Colin Stevens. Are you still on Offshore Music Radio? Are you still doing that one, or are you doing some more stuff? It's ABC Radio you're on. I don't know if you're still on Offshore as well. But happy birthday to you all, boys and girls. Here comes the song. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday. Happy birthday. Happy birthday to you. All right. Have enough birthday today, boys and girls. Whatever you're doing, have a nice time. Okay. Finally, our last little selection of messages today. Oh, that's it. Just a few little smiley faces there. Maybe I should wear one of these nappies. One of these. What are they called again? One minute. A puppy training pad to the karaoke tonight. Then I won't have to use the toilet there either, will I? I just put it on. Oh, look, my sister's just appeared. Right at the end of the show, Sharon. That's Sharon Butler. That's my dear, dear sister who lives up to north in Lincolnshire and keeps trying to get me to move up there nearer. You never know, sis. It might happen. That's it for the show today. Tonight, boys and girls, I shall be hosting karaoke this evening. That's at Central Station Bar in Wharfdale Road, King's Cross. All right. Karaoke tonight at Central Station Bar every Friday night. Central Station in Wharfdale Road, King's Cross. Show starts at 8:30. Get your songs in nice and early. And it finishes at 12 midnight. Karaoke tonight at Central Station, Wharfdale Road, King's Cross, London, every Friday, 8:30 till midnight. Thank you very much for watching and listening to the show today. I'll see you again very soon. Have a nice day. Bye-bye now.